Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess
to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have grievous sin in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my grievous fault. Therefore, I ask the Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all ye angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, and pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Show favor, O Lord, to your servants, and mercifully increase the gifts of your grace, that may fervent in hope, faith, and charity, they may be ever watchful in keeping your commandments. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Lord, you are good and for me. from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, the Spirit comes to the aid of our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes with inexpressible groanings. And the one who searches hearts knows what the intention of the Spirit, because he intercedes for the holy ones according to God's will. The word of the Lord.
He proposed another parable to them. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that a person took and sowed in a field. It is the smallest of all the seeds, and when full grown, it is the largest of plants. It becomes a large bush, and the birds of the sky come and dwell in its branches. He spoke to them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed with 3 measures of wheat flour until the whole batch was leavened. All these things Jesus spoke to the crowds in parables. He spoke to them only in parables to fulfill what had been said through the prophet. I will open my mouth in parables. I will announce what has lain hidden in the foundation of the world. Then, dismissing the crowds, he went into the house. His disciples approached him and said, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds in the field." He said in reply, "He who sows good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, the good seed the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sows them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the harvesters are angels. Just as weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all who cause others to sin and all evildoers. They will throw them into the fiery furnace, where there will be wailing and grinding of teeth. And the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of the Father. Whoever has ears ought to hear." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
the scriptures that are provided for us today really can be covered by reading the whole catechism of the Catholic Church, for we can always question ourselves, and many do. God, we know, is loving and he is good. So why is there evil and sin in the world? And we'll hear in many places in sacred scripture how evil came into the world. We know that it came about because of Satan himself, one of the angels God created, who somehow was filled with a pride that it wasn't good enough that he would be an angel, a spiritual being, with a superior intellect than all human beings would ever be created. Still, he wanted more. He wanted to be, in his own prideful way, even greater than God. And that pride caused him to fall from grace. And because he is a spiritual being, he will never be redeemed. Because he knows, obviously not as much as God, but when an angel makes a decision, a spiritual being with a superior intellect from us, then their decision is final. There is no chance of repentance for him. And because of that, he becomes, may say, even more angry, even more hateful, even more spiteful. And so because we are sort of lesser creatures than angels, but yet we are created in the image and likeness of God, we are both corporal and spiritual beings. And God has a great destiny for us. That destiny is to be with him forever in heaven, to enjoy eternal life for the rest of our existence. That means it will be without end once we're able to get to heaven. And if you know that somebody is going to enjoy something great and wonderful and you aren't, then that's where the pride, the evil of the devil comes in, that I don't want you to have something that I am not going to have, and so I will do everything in my power so that you will never be able to enjoy it. And so if we have that understanding, then we know why there is sort of evil in the world. God permits it for some reason. The reason is that he can bring a greater good out of what we are able to do on our own. That while it seems mysterious to us, and it is in our human capacity to be able to understand things, if it was not somehow for the sanctification of our souls and for the greater glory of God, then would not be able to exist. So if it is here, then we must trust that God will bring a great good out of it. And really that would be the next sentence that we had in the second reading from Paul's letter to the Romans. That God will bring good out of all things for those who are faithful to him. And so that's what God's plan of salvation is throughout all of history. And so the prophets in the Old Testament will try to explain that, will continually call the people back to living a life of holiness, to be faithful to the covenantal relationship that God had made with his people. But because of sin, we always have this tendency to not want to listen to God. We see that something is better for me. I want that. I don't want God. And so the struggle and the battle continues. And so in the Book of Wisdom, written roughly about 100 years before the incarnation of Christ, the author of this book is trying to sort of help the people to understand God. For they are now being sort of in Greece, and they are sort of following Greek culture. They are turning away from everything that their forefathers have had for centuries and centuries, and they are living in a way contrary to the will of God. And the author wants to call them back. And though he's speaking about God in the sense that you are master of might, and you judge with clemency, with much lenience you govern us, for power whenever you will attend you. And so God never wants to destroy us. Unfortunately, we can destroy ourselves because of the free will that we have. We can always choose to do something contrary to the will of God. But God is patient with us. He always wants to give us time to come to an understanding of what I just said, of how much he loves us, of our ultimate goal and purpose and destiny is to be with him forever in heaven. And so he wants to give us time to convert. He wants to give us time to repent. And really, that's the essence of the gospel passage that we have today. Our Lord is making it clear, in other words, the good and the evil. kingdom of heaven may be likened to a man who sowed good seed in his field. Yet while everyone was asleep, what does that mean? That sometimes we can let our guard down and we give the devil a chance to enter into us with temptations that we give into, with things that we know that are contrary to the will of God, but because we are sort of asleep or not alert or not ready to be able to say yes to what God wants for us in every situation, we somehow let him in. And so he sows those weeds within us. And we are both good and bad. If we are honest with ourselves, we know that. We do wonderful things, but at times we sin, and they would be bad things. But because God is patient with us, he doesn't want to destroy us. He wants to give us time to change, to repent. We know that in and of ourselves, but we also have examples of many saints throughout our church history. St. Augustine, when he writes this book of confessions, that it seemed like the worst thing that he did, that Fulgine would say, was to steal a pear and with his friends. But he did it with malice, in the sense that he knew that it was wrong. And yet he did it anyway. But God, in other words, was patient with him through the prayers of his mother Monica, through Augustine's finally coming at the age of 30, he repents and converts, and he becomes not only Bishop Augustine, but Saint Augustine. God showing us, in other words, that those weeds that were within him at the proper time were sort of uprooted by the angels, cleansed by the sacrament of baptism, brought into the life of God. And so God wants us to see and understand that. Not that we just allow sort of crime or sin or evil to exist without doing anything about it. Just there used to be a shirt years ago, kill them all and let God sort them out. That's not how it goes. We still try, we teach, we do good. We know that there is evil and violence in the world. We do everything that we possibly can to bring it to an end, to change people's minds. We know that we need protection, we need guidance. We thank God for our police officers. We thank God for those who are willing to provide peace and justice in our society. We know that we need that. We don't just bury our heads in the sand and say, let God do everything. But when we want conversion, we do not want the person doing something to sort of allow God to take them or kill them. We always pray for conversion of heart, mind, body, and soul. That's why God is patient with us, because we always need to grow and change. And he provides us with parables. Sometimes it's just that sort of small beginning. Somebody said something and touches my heart. That little mustard seed that's planted, the smallest of all seeds. Our church in the beginning with only 12 apostles, and it grows to billions and billions and billions of people over the century, and billions more until when Christ comes again. And we see, in other words, the other parables that our Lord spoke about. Heaven is like yeast that a woman took and measured, mixed with 3 measures of wheat flour. And the good, in other words, that is possible to be brought out. For if the flour just sits there on its own and does nothing, once that yeast is added to good, then it is able to become good bread for all. And this is what we need to see and understand. We have a God who loves us, a God who wants us to be with him. But it is really the Holy Spirit who brings this to our minds, who teaches us how we are to live, who teaches us how we are to pray. As we continue this holy sacrifice of the Mass, in the silence of our hearts, let us thank the Lord for revealing these truths to us. Let us thank him for being patient with us, for being lenient, giving us a chance to change, to grow in holiness, so that at the end of our earthly lives here, we may be able to be with him forever in heaven. And ask the Holy Spirit to continually guide you. Teach me how to pray. Teach me how to live always in accordance with the will of God, that every action that I may do may always be in accordance with his holy will. May God bless you.
permanent deacon and transitional deacon. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an increase in hospitality in our homes and in our hearts for those who come as guests, especially those who have little to offer in return. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God will protect from all evil and harm all those who serve in the protection and defense of life, especially our first responders and our servicemen and women serving at home and abroad. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the prayers we hold in our hearts will be united with those of Mary, the mother of Jesus, our patron Saint Andrew, and all the saints in light. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all our relatives and friends who have died, especially for whom we remember in a special way at this Mass.
Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, that through your goodness you have received the bread we offer you. Fruit of the earth, the work of human hands, will become for us bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, that through your goodness you have received the wine we offer you. Through the divine and work of human hands, will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept that sacrifice at your hand, the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the cause of the Church.
O God, when the one perfect sacrifice brought to completion very offerings of the law, accept, we pray, the sacrifice from your faithful servants, and make it holy as you bless the gifts of Abel, so that when each is offered to the honor of your majesty, may benefit the salvation of all. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation. Always and everywhere we give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, you laid the foundations of the world, have arranged the changing of times and seasons. You formed man in your own image, and set humanity over the whole world in all its wonder, to rule in your name over all you have made, and forever praise you in your mighty works, through Christ our Lord. And so with all the angels, we praise you, as in joyful celebration, we acclaim.
Thank you.
You are indeed, Holy the Lord, the fount of all things. Make holy, therefore, your gifts of prayer, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed, and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." Similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and Ronald our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, St. Andrew, St. Gaetano, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, you may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, "Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Amen.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
For those at home, we offer this prayer of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Let us pray. Graciously be present to your people, we pray, Lord. Lead those you have imbued with heavenly mysteries to pass from former ways to newness of life. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth glorifying the Lord by your life.